I want to thank Ms. Davis for the work that she has put in this. We have had many discussions with Dr. Graham, as well as with others that are involved in providing services, justice services, in crafting this paper. And I've asked Joyce if she would come as well and give us some more detailed highlights as it relates to this paper, the merit of this paper, and then I will also follow up with comments and attempt to answer any questions that may come up as a result of it. Thank you.
Ms. Davis.
Good evening, members of the Public Safety Committee. I passed out a sheet that you had. It's a one-pager, and it's about an 11 or 10-point font. So I hope that you can see it. I'm having difficulty myself in this lighting. But Mrs. Robertson has already laid out the various components of this paper. There were some questions about how this committee lines up, the Citizen Advisory Committee that's being proposed by this particular paper, how it lines up with CCJB. The first thing that I want to point out is this is a Citizen Advisory Committee on Alternatives to Incarceration, but the emphasis is on citizen involvement, whereas with the Community Criminal Justice Board, it is comprised of key representatives from the criminal justice community, and it also would include a citizen, but there are fewer citizens that actually participate on the Community Criminal Justice Board that are envisioned with this particular committee. Some of the activities, the difference in some of the activities, and I have that at the end of the paper, but off the top, this board could be involved in some type of advocacy or city council watch on other policies or laws that are being recommended, whereas the Community Criminal Justice Board would not participate in anything political of that nature. So if you look at what I have here as far as the number of members, we propose in this paper 15 members, and I have 15 plus because there's an opportunity to add to the community if you were to have subcommittees to work on a variety of projects. For the Community Criminal Justice Board, there are 12 minimum positions that you have to have. And so my second column that you see here, the membership composition, I'll switch to the second side, which is the CCJB. The key representatives are from the criminal justice system, and that is by code. The Virginia Code 9.1-178 says that you must have, at a minimum, a judge from the General District Court, a judge from the Juvenile Domestic Relations Court, and also one from the Circuit Court, as well as the Chief Magistrate, the Sheriff, the Chief of Police, the Commonwealth Attorney, a public defender, or at least a person who is vested in representing individuals from the other side, opposite prosecution, a local educator, and a representative from the Community Services Board, and a citizen. That's at a minimum, and then other members can be appointed. And so we've had other members of city administration or other citizens that have been appointed to add to the number of that committee. This committee, the composition, the Citizen Advisory Committee, would consist of some of those same stakeholders, but primarily citizens, community corrections, service providers, members from law enforcement, social services, representatives from the faith-based community, the education and business communities for workforce investment, from the Minority Business Development Center, from technical education for higher ed. And then because there is a concern about residential facilities, an administrator of a residential facility, halfway houses, or group homes, et cetera, that we have located in our community. City Council would nominate 8 members, and the mayor would nominate 7 members. And again, other members could be appointed on an as-needed basis or utilized as a part of those subcommittees. The number of citizen positions, we estimate to be about four on the Citizen Advisory Committee, whereas there's one on CCJB, although others can be appointed on either of these. But individuals that serve on CCJB, as well as the anticipated Citizen Advisory Committee, are typically individuals from the Richmond community and are actually citizens. So your sheriff or your judges actually live in the city of Richmond. And had your court caterers that have been selected in the past have lived in the city of Richmond. The purpose of it is to provide a perspective from citizens on a variety of issues that impact the community with community-based service facilities, as well as to look at the impact of the local corrections alternatives to incarceration. For example, the CCJB creates a biennial plan, and in that biennial plan, there were four recommendations that were made. One was to increase specialty housing and homeless programs targeted for offenders, a special docket for mental illness, which we consider as the mental health court, to increase the capacity of substance abuse treatment and recovery programs, and to implement best practices for pretrial and community-based programs. Their overall goal in that plan was to reduce the jail census by approximately 400 persons and to keep the jail population at 1,032 persons as a part of that population. The same would be true for this committee to look at what they are doing and to make sure, as the newspaper article pointed out on Sunday, that they are keeping to the alternatives that have been recommended, or to ensure that that population is maintained at 1,000 as has been promised by the biennial plan. Some of the other activities that this committee could look at is in the jail, whereas they might have 1,000 in the population, you can do a study to figure out what that particular population consists of. If they are individuals that are Richmond committed, or if they are from other counties. And so one activity could be that this committee could look at the number of individuals that are being held for other localities, and if that has an impact on whether we're up in our census count, in our jail census count. Another activity of the committee would be to review the biennial plan, as I mentioned before, and to assess the effectiveness of the plan and the impact on the jail population, as well as they could offer public comments on proposed zoning application as it relates to the conservation of programs and if there's an equitable distribution of program services for residential facilities that are making an application to our zoning department. And we've talked about requiring the state to recommend for us or to have in place laws that would say if you're applying for a zoning application that you would have to get a special use permit if you are a group home. And in the case of group homes, I'll say for residential or for mental health, they may not have to go through that process for, say, juvenile or mental health facilities. But for someone that is applying for a halfway house for adult offenders, they may have to go through the process to get a special use permit. And so this group could serve as a city council watch for special use permits of that nature as it relates to zoning. But again, their responsibility would be to look at policy recommendations and practices that impact the community. And so in the 3rd District, as well as the 6th District, there's a very high concentration of group home programs that we've discussed in other council meetings, as well as halfway houses for residential treatment programs. And I've also listed the responsibilities of both committees here. If you would like for me to answer questions or continue any other discussion, I can. Do you have any questions?
I do have a question. What will be the relationship between this advisory group and CCJV?
The relationship that...
I understand the distinctions, but I mean,
the distinction?
How will they work, or will they work together in employee?
They will work together not only with CCJV, but also in partnership with the jail. I do think that there will be times when they may work collaboratively, but I think that there will be other times when they would actually point out different problems that they see and asking for some type of resolution or identifying issues. So they would work with CCJV. When you look at the biennial plan, this committee could ask the same type of questions either to council or to CCJV on how they would accomplish some of the goals that are set out. So when you look at this plan right now that says that you will reduce the jail population to 1,000 and that there's going to be a jail census of 400, you have to look at it and say how. And then this committee would be working with them to make sure that they are doing what they said or asking the right questions of if what they're saying is truthful or not, or if it's feasible or not. I guess it's a better way of saying it.
Any other questions?
Yes. Would this advisory board be advisory commission? Funding?
Not as of this time. There's nothing in here requesting funding.
All right. And secondly, one of its primary focus would be, as I understand it, advisories as to how to implement, what to implement in way of alternatives to sentencing, and how to implement it, or is that coming from somewhere else?
Did you ask the question for me, and I was instructed to do something else to make a note?
I'm asking, is this commission supposed to devise ways and means of alternatives to incarceration and ways and means to implement the same?
I think that's where the difference of this committee and CCJV comes into play. These are citizens that do not necessarily have the expertise unless they are specialized and placed on a committee to make the actual recommendation for the alternatives. That will be the job and the scope of the CCJV to lay out the actual plan. The goal of this committee would be to ensure that they're either on track with what they're saying, if they are going to purchase 50 monitors, how many people are actually utilizing those monitors, where they are being placed in the community. It may come down to something as far as the actual practices. For example, I was explaining to Mrs. Robertson and them today that when I was conducting the mapping of group homes and residential facilities, one of the things that I found out is that some of our community corrections agencies use one set of apartments for sexual offenders. And so they use one particular group so that those offenders would stay there. And so they're concentrated in a particular area. If we were aware of something like that, we could even bring that to the attention if they thought there was a public safety risk. And so there are particular issues like that that citizens would be concerned about as opposed to CCJV.
So as a protective measure for citizens and community, they would monitor and they would monitor the program as it's being worked, these alternatives, and even in some instances be an advocate, not only for those formerly incarcerated, but also for the community, where things get out of kilter and out of balance.
Yes. the workforce or minority business community, they would be a part of whatever the entry resources that could be put in place or that are not in place right now. I would like, if you have no more questions, I need to go back to something. All three of us made a minimum at the same time. That's why I got distracted. When you asked me about funding, the funding that is included in this paper and that is anticipated is for staff. You have to allocate what the staff costs and resources are for the paper. And so your paper indicates that at least $5,000 would be allocated towards staff time. However, that particular staff person is already in the position, but we have to, according to one of the ordinances that we have to spell out what the anticipated cost would be that would take up that person's time.
I see the necessity, thank you, I see the necessity for this kind of advisory board or commission. I'm just not there yet on whether, in fact, there's a need for such a commission. If we haven't gotten word that the judges, the magistrates, and the Commonwealth Attorney is going to even cooperate enough that we will have these alternatives, has anything worked in that regard to give us more assurance that there will be alternatives?
I think that's a question that Mr. Fleming can answer, but I can answer it. I think Ms. Robinson was going to add to it, but
that part of this, the reason why we would continue this is because we really wanted to at least have more input as to exactly the implementation of the alternatives. But, when I read the article in the paper on Sunday, I think there are two things that is of great concern as it relates to the necessity for the citizens to be engaged in this process. We definitely want to make sure that the citizens are engaged in understanding what the plan is, the total plan for alternatives to incarceration. And we want them to be aware and educated of how this program works to the degree that they would be advocates to support those kinds of alternative services, because frequently the alternative to services, especially if they are residential-based services, become an issue as to whose neighborhood, who wants to live in their neighborhood. And when there is not an advisory board involved in that process and understand the process and operation and expectations and what they should expect from such facilities and so forth and so on, it tends not to be readily accepted by communities. So I think we need to do that from the perspective of educating the community, that through the citizens' advisory boards' involvement and discussion on that, because when it's next door to my house versus someone else that is nowhere near their homes, as it relates to, and then we talk about Chamberlain Avenue, and we talk about other parts of the city where there may be services that may not be received by the community in a very positive way. But the community doesn't know what those services and how they get involved in that discussion on those services. We want the community to recognize that if we're ever going to reduce the concentration, if ever reduce the incarceration rates, that there have to be alternative services, and we've got to be on top of how we manage those facilities. So this body would be an educated body of citizens that can help us in that process. But likewise, they will also be a body of citizens that are engaged in that process that can say, Mr. Jones had 50 houses and all 50 of them, he doesn't follow any of the regulatory requirements and so forth and so on that is going on, and he's asking for to set up another property or something of this nature. The other thing is that if we're not meeting our expectations and our goals as it relates to reducing the concentration. This advisory board, with the diversity of membership that we have on there, can also be more of an advocate to help us with the workforce and small business and all of the other kinds of cultural kinds of things that we talk about all the time that can help make them look at those assets or the absence of such assets in communities that have a concentration or heavy concentration of uses and so forth. And so I think that we need the people's voice in this process so that we can be effective in finding the alternatives.
Got that part. I told you, I understand this paper and I applaud it. My concern is different. My concern is, have we cleared up whether the criminal justice system is going to play ball with alternatives to incarceration? I haven't heard any briefing on that yet.
Well, I think that we could ask for that, Mr. Chair, that we get a briefing from those persons and answer that.
I think we can, but I do want to have us remember that we committed resources to alternatives to incarceration, several of them that were mentioned, the home electronic monitoring, the mental health docket, and those things are underway. Some of the question was whether or not they would, as quickly as anticipated, result in the reduction or certainly maintaining that lower population count in the jail. So yes, they are engaged, and I certainly went over to Manchester to observe the mental health docket. So they are involved. I think the question is not so much that as much as, will this, have we invested enough, will we deliver as quickly, will we maintain the on-front? So there's still some.
Again, judges are going to decide whether they're going to play ball with it.
Right, and they have.
And they have the
Commonwealth Attorney that decides
that
they're going
to
play
ball with it. Yes, and they have.
But that doesn't preclude having any report.
Yeah, we need an update on if it's working, how's it working.
Right.
The other point, though, I went to a forum, sort of affiliated with the fatherhood program. I think we were at the Performing Arts Center where they had this thing. And on the panel, there was Commonwealth Attorney Michael Perry, Sheriff C.T. Woody, and African-American social worker, gentleman from Ashland, Analyst, one of them. They were talking about how to reduce the levels of incarceration, number one, and how to reduce recidivism. Yet, no one talked about the fact that you can go Monday through Friday to Manchester Court, General District Court, three courtrooms full of people, and you won't find four white people as defendants in the room. And it just seems to me that at some point before we get at any of this, we've got to address whether, in fact, law enforcement views African Americans as the very object of law enforcement. You ain't convincing me that white people don't commit crimes. Yet all the heat and light of law enforcement is focused on African Americans and Hispanics. And so before we get to all of this, when did we get to that?
Well,
now, I know this is a real different kind of thing, but I'm saying to you
and I do hear
of this is relevant to what we're trying to do here.
I hear the concern. I do want to press us in terms of this particular item. Maybe that is something that gets added.
I'm fine with this, and I'm ready to move on this. That's not my issue.
Okay, so then let
I need a report as to whether initial efforts at alternatives to incarceration, number one, is being implemented and to what extent through some kind of a briefing.
Okay.
And then secondly, the more fundamental question is, who are we policing and why?
And I know that you're saying you support that and I agree, but I think with this, when Marty Jewell is not asking that question, this advisory board will be asking those questions. And I think that is the citizens' involvement and interest that this paper lends itself to.
Certainly, all of us are for it, and that is just, even from community folks, and Marty Jewell.
Yes.
Okay, with that.
I mean, that just sums up the question that Mr. Jewell asked. Those are the kinds of things that are indicated about policy recommendations or practices that are occurring. And so to your question about if the representatives from the criminal justice system are on board, we have currently in place pretrial community corrections and the awareness from the judges, because we have all three on, but we have one of the best worker relationships with judges as well as the Commonwealth attorneys right now that we've ever had in over 30 years, with all of them on board, with the police chief as well as the CA and the public defender. It still does require them at the end of the day to rule and to place people on the various alternatives to correction, but we have a better collaborative relationship with those key stakeholders.
And as long as that's reflective in the numbers, then we're making progress and we all want to celebrate.
But we do need a report, and that's what this committee would ask. This committee would ask and review that report to make sure when you read the sort of 17 bullet points that we have here, one of them is that you would assess and make sure of the effectiveness of the alternatives that are in place. That's something separate that CCJB would do. They would certainly look at it for one reason, but this committee would look at it for other reasons and would make you aware of that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
With that, I'm going to open up the public comment.
Good evening, Madam Chair. My name is Rufus Fleming, and I'm here to represent the Department of Justice Services for the city. Very good presentation, excellent, and I embrace everything that Ms. Davis is talking about. And I agree also, Ms. Robinson, that we do need to have citizen participation in this process. But I would like to offer an alternative to the alternatives. I think we all recognize that we must have address this issue of individuals inordinately being incarcerated for some crimes that they shouldn't be incarcerated for. But I'd like for us to at least consider an alternate approach to this in trying to accomplish the same goal. And that would be to have the ordinance that authorized the, even though state law requires it, the ordinance that authorized the establishment of the CCJB in the city, that it be amended to increase the numbers of individuals on that committee to include members of the public, and just establish a standing committee so they work in tandem with the CCJB, as opposed to trying to create what could be perceived as an atmosphere of competition. And I think if we were to take that approach, I think we would be very successful in accomplishing exactly what this paper proposes.
I would add to what he just said. The state code allows you to have already, you can do that. It allows you to have at minimum the members that are indicated. You can add to that number state code, not necessarily city code, although we have it in our city code. But again, that subcommittee would still have to report up to those particular judges. And so for the case that, the example that was just given about the alternatives, if they don't want to go any further, I agree, it would have a less contentious relationship and spirit of their worker relationship. But the goal is not necessarily to do that, but it is to identify projects I foresee that if we had had this committee, that with the juvenile detention center, that it would have been a more systematic way that some of the complaints could have been brought, and then this committee could have written a report and gone to the CCJD. So again, the goal is for this committee to work with CCJD and not against them. And obviously, they would have to figure out how to approach various projects so that that would be maintained.
Well, I guess my position is that perception in a lot of cases of reality is some of them. And I'm just wondering whether or not a separate committee would receive the full support of the CCJP as opposed to working in tandem with it and just having that steering committee or permanent steering committee to address just some of the issues that you just laid out a few minutes ago.
Okay. And I don't want to have a back and forth between the two of you. I want you to have opportunity to share, so, and especially since the patron of the paper is here as well as the staff.
I do believe that.
I'm still in public comment, okay. So you've had anything else, Mr. Fleming, you want to say? Okay. I think I have another citizen.
Hello, my name is Silver Persinger. I'm a citizen of Richmond, Virginia. I would like to second the gentleman's suggestion to amend the CCJB committee. I have a lot of problems with this paper. First of all, you all know that Mrs. Robertson is the chairwoman of the Finance and Economic Development Committee. That's what this is. This is an economic development paper for the community surrounding the city jail. I'm troubled when my councilman asked, because it's in the paper, he should have read it. It's $5,000 a year is what they're proposing to spend on this. If you combined with the other committee, that's a savings of $5,000 a year. Let's see, I'm also concerned about the composition. Ms. Robertson says she wants to involve the community, but only 8 members are required to live in the city. So I assume you want to also involve members, citizens from Henrico, Chesterfield, or wherever. I object to that. I only want people from the city of Richmond to be on this committee. I support some of these compositions for the committee. I think someone from higher education institutions should be involved, like VCU or J. Sergeant Reynolds or something like that. I also think law enforcement should be involved, which probably already is in the CCJB. I also like that social services involved. I think they should be involved. But I think other people who should be involved are mental health professionals and substance abuse specialists. Let's see, I thought this was going to be just like a one-off thing, but I guess it's going to go on forever is what's being proposed here. Members are supposed to have 2-year terms, and I don't support creating a new board because until recently the city's had a hard time even staffing the boards that we currently have. Let's see. Oh, one of my other objections is the goals of the committee. The first 4 goals of the committee are all economic development. This thing says the commission shall make recommendations to the city council and the mayor concerning the following. 1, solutions to any problems within communities of the city related to property values, real estate taxes, police fire services. And keep in mind, this is supposed to be alternatives to incarceration. We're talking about property values and real estate taxes. That's not alternatives to incarceration. 2, the ways to establish inclusive, affordable housing that enhances the city's real property values, supports public safety. Again, it's affordable housing that's not supposed to be alternatives to incarceration. 3, strategies to make the Justice Center an economic engine for the immediate and surrounding community and the city as a whole. Again, that's economic development. 4, strategies to generate public support for alternatives to incarceration. Well, that's actually a legitimate purpose, but the first three stated goals are all economic development. And I have just a couple more objections. This one, item 11 of the stated goals of this proposed commission, the development of private business enterprises to provide employment to residents of the Justice Center and persons reentering the community after incarceration. I don't object to providing jobs to people after they get out of jail. I think that is a good goal. But I do object to possibly, with provisions, I could support this employment to residents of the Justice Center, such as paying minimum wage. The city has this program where they pay inmates $10 a day to cut grass and trees and move trash, and I don't want to see that program extended. My final objection is item 15, the feasibility of creating a reserve fund to purchase and resell homes which have not sold at fair market value due to the proximity of such homes to the Justice Center. Well, that is part of the fair market value. Its proximity to the jail will affect its fair market value, and what it sounds like is being proposed compensating private individuals for the lower cost of their house because of the proximity to the city jail, which is the same proximity to the city jail that currently exists. Thank you for the opportunity to comment.
Thank you for your comments. With that, seeing no other issues.
I've got one question.
Would you state your name?
Oh, yeah. Melvin Jones. What's the requirements of the citizen, if a citizen was to be on this? The requirements, background check or?
If you do background checks on people to serve, but it would be, you mean to serve on this commission?
Yeah.
It would go through the same process that we have for any other board, that you would make an application to the clerk's office, with a request to serve here, and council will ultimately vote on their recommendations of who to serve on the board.
And another thing I want to add to it, we do have quite a few halfway hours. He had said something about, I noticed in the north side, in my area, I see a lot of whites and blacks in those apartments, which is halfway out, so I know that's going on. So, seems like it's working out all right. We haven't had a problem yet with it, but I'm quite sure the neighbors don't know what's going on in the neighborhood. So, we need halfway houses over on River Road, Cherokee Road, put them somewhere else too, let people know what it is to be in another area too, besides, condensed, like you said, with people from the project, if you want to say, or whatever. I just want to add that to it.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Seeing none, I'll bring it back to the committee.
Suggesting in this paper that any of these these things may, all of these things may or may not, but we wanted to at least give the commission enough understanding that we recognize that prevention of being incarcerated and alternatives to incarceration extend beyond the judge's decision as it relates to you getting in, not going to jail. And so many of these things that have been pointed out may be perceived as we're looking at economic development opportunities, and perhaps it will generate some economic development opportunities. But if it does so with as a part of an alternative strategy, then we are really creating opportunities for these people to not have other factors impeding them from being able to stay out of jail.
I look at what Boys and Rufus is doing over in your neighborhood, in your district. I don't know whether these folks are paid a wage, but they've brought back some god-awful houses to the point that they fix them up and they're living in them and paying rent. That is economic development, using that same very population to as a part of their rehabilitative efforts. So I don't know that I got any heartburn whatsoever with this, and I'm sure these concepts can be expanded. Just today, I went over to DOC, Rufus, where Second Chance got a chance to go before an appeal hearing as to why their license was pulled. 16 beds made available for ex-offenders, and you can't find enough beds for ex-offenders. One's economy, the very foundation of an individual's economy is a stable home. And we don't have that, we got nothing. And so, housing is hugely important and ought to be this whole, the whole mindset. So I support the paper. I'm prepared to vote.
Number 15, the feasibility of creating a reserve fund to purchase or resale of homes that maybe that the fair market may be impacted as it relates to the Justice Center or other services as it relates to that. What happens a lot of times, I think, with community residents, and here again, this body, we want them to be informed and educated enough that they can also be advocates to help us support community engagement in providing alternative residential housing and services for, as you mentioned with Boaz and Ruth. One of the reasons why sometimes residents do not want these services in their community is because they claim that they decrease their property. Now, whether that's true or not, it's not an issue. I mean, it is an issue. I'm not saying that we validated that. What I am saying that in cases where there has been validation that property value is directly impacted because of something, that the city, and this could be something that is looking at as far as our affordable housing trust fund, where we see that there is a void of market value, that people have some sense of assurance that if that is the case, that there's the city has taken that into consideration.
I get your point. In fact, if there's a negative impact because of the proximity to the facility.
But that would have to be paid. Would have to validate that. And there is no.
You get the EDA to buy it.
Okay, if I'm a little stuck here in this morning because we're talking about an entity that looks at evaluates, promulgates alternatives to incarceration. It looks at what CCJB has put forth and monitors, follows. This one just throws me a bit, I guess.
in this,
because it's not clearly an alternative in any form or fashion. And I understand what, where it goes to make whole, what community member that potentially might be impacted because some alternative is, but I didn't see that as a purview entity, I guess. Not that there is not a place for them.
And here again, it's an advisory board that we make a recommendation of policy and procedures to the city council and to the mayor. They, if we find, when people Google a neighborhood and they find that the apartment complex for all sex offenders is located in my neighborhood, and that has a negative impact on the marketability of the community, they may make a recommendation as to what relates to how we deal with those kinds of initiatives. I'm not saying that that would be the case, but I know, because I live one block from many of the houses that you speak, that we often speak of as relates to Boaz and Ruth. And I know what happens as it relates to that and how the community is impacted.
I'm not disagreeing with you at all. It just, in this context, was really more of the question, given what the charge has been set forth for this particular entity. So I'm not at all saying that. I absolutely, without a shadow of a doubt. So, and I won't, I mean, we need to bring this to closure, but, so that was the only place.
I'd like to weigh in, if I may.
Yes.
It makes perfectly good sense to me. If a property has been impacted by lower value, it may be necessary for that advisory board to pay. Number one, it is a place for them to go. I don't know that they got a permit that owner has right now a forum to take his or her complaint. Number two, that group may have, having passed that on to council, there may be a need to purchase that house by the housing authority or some other entity and convert it into residential housing for our population. And giving that property owner relief at the same time. I know exactly what you're talking about. I think it's valid that we need to have a forum where people can go and make that kind of a complaint to seek redress.
Okay, and so I'm just going to bring us to decisioning, but I do want to clarify, I was not suggesting that it's not valuable and important to have. I was only inquiring as to whether or not this was the entity, given that this is set forth as alternatives to incarceration, as opposed to ways to mitigate impact on citizens in communities where we have a, an abundance of, alternatives, whether it's residential. That was my only question. Not that it doesn't have value, it's whether it's here. So
the community, CC, what is it, JB, is a dark place as far as John Q. Marty Citizen is concerned. I've never been to a board meeting, never been invited to it, don't know when they meet, don't know what they do. John Q. Citizen couldn't get squat done going through that organization. This appears to be an intentionally community forum opportunity for people to interact with this criminal justice system that they otherwise don't have.
Okay, and I'm just going to do one last. I want to say that because I do sit on the CCJD board, it is open and people can attend.
No outreach. We don't know anything about it.
I'm just stating what has been my experience. It is open to the public. People can sit in. There's an opportunity even for public comment. People can definitely attend and sit in. So it's not closed.
No, I'm not.
Yeah. So with this last comment.
The misunderstanding about this paper, even when we were writing it, is that it has something to do with CCJB, or that it's, well, I just want to finish, or that it's CCJB. One of the things that I struggle with, Ms. Robertson, is how we would name the paper, that it would be called alternative. alternatives to incarceration because I knew that there would be a confusion and too much of an alliance. That's why I started out trying to separate. It's possible that between this committee and the next, if it is advanced, that we could look at what things that we could change, even the title. As you all were talking about alternatives to incarceration with so much emphasis on that, really if you turn it around and look at that some of this paper, the purpose is for alternatives for the individual not to be incarcerated. And so when we're looking at housing or we're looking at the success of those particular alternatives, as Mr. Jewell mentioned before, the pretrial component as well as community corrections, when you divert that person out through what the jail plan recommends, then you still have to work with that individual with social services. So there are general relief issues, there are housing issues for that person. So when we call it this alternative to incarceration, it may have more to do with trying to make sure that the individual is more stabilized and those things in the community are more stabilized.
I appreciate the clarification, Ms. Davis, but I absolutely agree with you. Unless you create a turnstile, you have to have those supportive services in addition to those you mentioned a bit more. So thank you for that additional clarification. I am going to ask for your pleasure.
Move to advance with recommendation.
I would like to move similarly, but with some, just really taking another look at what's articulated in like in item number 15, just really being vigilant that this gets us to that particular goal, what's articulated for those more than 15 items. I think prior to those, other than that one, that was the major one for me, but other than that. So if as a friendly offer just to revisit and make sure that those are developed. With that, Mr. Clark, I think we have concluded the review of the papers. And so we would, I'd like to go back to an item that Mr. Jewell raised. And it was motioned and moved to
advance.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, thank you. With comment. It's such a thing as possible. And then Mr. Jewell mentioned status report in terms of progress to date on the implementation of alternatives to incarceration, as well as the police policing department. So were you looking that for that to be or that would come out of this committee, or are you asking for a report in terms of the alternatives that have been already articulated and are underway?
Wanted an update on how well those alternatives are.
So you're looking for one now, before report.
For
so
report.
I want
yeah.
to add, if we could add a for the next meeting a report now in terms of those alternatives. And they now held on the aging home electronic monitoring substance use. And there may be some others I'm not aware of, but it's at least those three that City Council directed resources towards. Then the